Hello, everybody. Roger Durling, Executive Director of the Santa Barbara International Film Festival. And I'm so delighted to have with us visual effects artist Leslie Ekker. He has given us, he's lent his creative genius to such projects as True Lies, Apollo 13, Titanic, Blade Runner, Ghostbusters, Die Hard, Bram Stoker's Dracula, the Francis Ford Coppola, Star Trek, the motion picture, and Close Encounters Special Edition, amongst many other films. Welcome, Leslie. But before we start talking, I want to show a little clip from your work in Apollo 13, which you were nominated for the Oscar for best special effects. So let's take a peek.
7, 6, emission sequence start. 3, 2, 1, ignition.
Welcome, Leslie, again. So excited you're here. Right before we came, we went live, I was mentioning to you what an incredible career you've had and the films you've worked on, from Titanic, Apollo 13, Blade Runner. These are all classics, modern classics. When you look back at what you've done, how do you feel about your accomplishments?
Well, I'm mainly grateful because honestly, it was all a big accident. I was never meant to go into film at all. And I had the good fortune to be living with a college roommate and a good friend, Mark Stetson, who is quite a luminary in his own right. And he had just gotten off work and I had just graduated and I was sitting on the couch wondering, how the heck am I gonna find a job? I don't know how to start. I had just graduated from Art Center College in Pasadena with a degree in industrial design. And my roommate had taken time off to earn some money and he got a job in Hollywood on Star Trek, the motion picture, helping build the first enterprise model. He came home and said, oh, my boss is looking for a couple of guys. Maybe you should go and interview and see what happens. So I did. About 12 of us went in and his boss hired two of us. I was one of them. And that was it. That was the beginning for me.
Now, I mean, your degree in, you know, from Art Center College Design, I mean, you could use the stuff that you learn into model making, right, for the movies, correct?
Yeah, it was interesting. You know, at first I wasn't so sure, but ultimately the definition of what we were doing is that we're building things that had never been made before, doing things no one had ever done before. And so it's really the same where you have a goal to achieve a certain function and you design something to achieve that efficiently. It needs to work within a budget on a schedule. And you know, we were taught how to do that. It was just that what we were actually making were frames of film and not refrigerators.
I was doing research for our conversation and somewhere I read that you're comfortable in, you have a working knowledge of physics, mm-hmm. engineering, historiography, cinematography, drafting art. You know, is that stuff that you learn in college that you were fascinated in college?
Well, yes and no. Some of that, yes, but honestly, I'm not a very good student in terms of school. But I'm a knowledge addict and I'm a compulsive reader of science. And in those days, I was a compulsive reader of catalogs. industrial catalogs, like people who make epoxy resins and people who sell aircraft fasteners. And, you know, I just was interested in that stuff. Don't ask me why. And so I learned a tremendous amount about engineering and chemistry and physics. I've always been kind of a natural at physics. That's a given. But I'm terrible in math. So the combination of the two was always kind of awkward for me. An example would be in Apollo, when the capsule splashes down in the ocean, it has to float a certain depth and at a certain angle. So the hatch is on the high side, and then it has to hit the water with enough force to make the right kind of splash, and all that had to be calculated. So I had to force myself to use my gut understanding of engineering, which is really all it is, and my knowledge of physics and my terrible math to figure out exactly how to make that thing.
Mm-hmm. Now, I read that you were born in Hollywood. Is that correct?
And yeah,
you
were born in the hills.
And you were raised the whole time. I mean, wasn't it predestined for you to have a career in cinema?
It would appear so, but no. I grew up in a fashion and design family. My dad and mom were in the fashion industry. My mother was French, my father Hungarian. And I grew up in a household of, you know, very good taste and sporting. They were both athletic, and I was always interested in art and had a gift for building things. When I was a kid, I used to make my own toys, and there was something called an Erector set, this thing you'd bolt together little structures. And
yeah, correct. I remember those.
Yeah, all that. So that was a natural for me. So I had an inclination, and it's an amusing story. This is the kind of thing that I hope young people today experience as well. I was in high school. I went to Kate School in Carpinteria.
Oh, so, my goodness.
Yeah.
Your family was living in Hollywood and they sent you to Kate School?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, boarding school. It was great. I loved it. It's an amazing school. So it was time to graduate, and I had no idea what I was going to do in college. I was going to go to UCSD, but who knows what I was going to major in. And so I was walking to dinner, and my physics teacher, Hans Sommers, an Austrian gentleman who came across after World War II to teach physics at this, you know, cushy boys' school, came out, and we were good friends because I was good in his class and he appreciated my enthusiasm. And so he said to me, "Well, Leslie, what are you going to do when you graduate?" And honestly, I told him, "I don't know." I said, "Well, what do you like to do?" And that's a question that no one had ever asked me. And that's a question I think we need to ask every young person. What do you like to do? What turns you on? And I told him, "Well, I've been in the art room a lot and doing a lot of stuff in the wood shop. You know, I like physics and all that, but I don't know." So he said, "Well, it sounds to me like you should look into industrial design." And I had never heard of that before. It was a new term for me. So after dinner, I went to the library and I looked up a book, Raymond Loewy, the world's first real industrial designer. And it just blew my mind. And so I called my mom, "Mom, there's this thing, industrial design." And she said, "Oh, you know, I've been reading this book by Alex Haley called Wheels. And they talk about industrial designers designing cars. And they all came from this school in the book called the Art Center. I wonder if it's real." She looked in the yellow pages, and sure enough, it was about 2 miles from our house in Hollywood. So that's how I discovered my path, is through this book my mom was reading and my physics teacher, Hans Sommers, bless his heart.
And then you mentioned that it was your roommate that mentioned that they were looking for people to work on Star Trek, which This was 1979.
January, yeah. So Mark came home. Mark Stetson, he's fun to Google. Mark Stetson won the Oscar for visual effects on Lord of the Rings. He had been working, like as I said, as a model maker, because he had that skill from back east working in a product design laboratory. And so when I was hired on Star Trek, my first jobs were designing video displays to see on the bridge set and different kinds of graphics for the spaceship models, stripes and the, you know, numbers on the front of the Enterprise, just doing all that graphical work, which was, you know, easy for me. I've been trained how to do that. And then Paramount fired the company that we were working for, who was contracted to do the entire visual effects for the film. They'd worked for a year and hadn't produced a frame of film. So the studio panicked and they fired those guys and brought in Douglas Trumbull, who's a very well-known name in visual effects. He gained fame through 2001. He was one of the people involved with that. Correct. So Doug took it on, and his shop was down in Marina Del Rey. And so we were instantly fired and rehired by this new company. And we all moved down to the marina and they put me in the art department because I'm doing graphics. And when you get hired in Hollywood in those days, you had to be in a union. So the people who hired me just kind of stuck me in the animation union because in those days they would take anybody and I was anybody. And so, so now this film production is now in a panic. We have 11 months to produce 2 years worth of visual effects. So they have this animation at the end of the movie to create the big culminating climax of the film is this wild animation thing. And so they look down their list and they see Les Ekker, Animation Union. Okay, give it to him. And I kid you not, a sweaty PA runs into my office, slaps down this stack of prints of the end of the film, just stills of the frames at the end of the film, and said, animate the movie, and ran away. It was exactly like that. He was in a panic because they were just throwing jobs at people, tasks at people, assignments, you know? And I was like, oh my God, what just happened? And 2 days later, my visual effects supervisor, Robert Swarth, came in and said, oh, relax, it's actually easy. Here's all you gotta do. You draw a line on a white card and you make a negative and you take two of those negatives and you put them on top of each other. And when you move them, a dot of light moves because it's like a scissor thing, right? It's called a slot mask animation. To me, it was new, but it was a well-known technique. So I figured that out. I taught myself how to do it and produced all the animation at the end of the film. And then we were all fired, laid off because we were done. And this was new to me. I thought when you get a job, you keep working, right? Go to the next thing or whatever, but not in the film industry. And so, oh, I need to plug my computer in. Wow, my battery is low. So I had to land on my feet, and I love that kind of challenge. I've always thrived on that sort of thing. So I thought, design refrigerators or make more money, have union coverage and insurance, and be challenged every moment on your job. It was a no-brainer. I wanted to remain in film. And so my friend in the meantime, Mark Stetson, started to his own company building miniatures for movies because he saw this was an interesting thing to do. And he worked for Doug, and Doug's first movie after Star Trek was Blade Runner. And so Mark said, hey, Les, come work for me. You're good at in the shop. You know, he knew I could build and said, yeah, you can do this stuff. And so I came in and that was my first model making job.
Incredible. Before we start talking about Blade Runner, let's take a quick peek at Star Trek from 1979.
Okay.
There you are. You were plugged. I was going to ask you that you were very nonchalant about this, but this was 1979. Star Wars had been released a few years earlier, and Star Trek was a huge deal. And here you are, fresh out of college, and your first gig is with the highly anticipated Star Trek.
Like I say, I was lucky.
While you were working on this, were you aware of the fact that this was a pretty big deal, this film?
Well, you know, I really appreciated the job because it was pretty cool. And I was working with fascinating people. That's really the best part of my career is the people I've worked with have been just fascinating. But for us, honestly, Star Wars took all of the magic. Right. And so we were working on like, oh, they're making a TV show into a movie now. So there was a kind of an attitude of like, well, I'm not sure we really matter. Thanks, Sophie. Can you plug it in? I got a power supply now.
There you go.
So, you know, we were suffering from a bit of an inferiority complex because we were being overshadowed by Star Wars, and, you know, in many ways, justifiably so. My assistant, Diane, is going to plug in my computer power supply. I wish I'd noticed it was low before. My apologies.
That's quite all right. There's no worries. I love the fact that we're having a conversation with a visual effects master, and then we're watching him at work.
Well, my battery's dead. See? Thank you, darling. Diane. The fabulous Diane. So we were a bit of an inferiority complex because Star Wars, and we knew they were working on more of them, and that was a little scary in a sense, because how are we going to top that? And then we also knew what movie we were working on. We had the script. And so the joke among us ever since then was that the title of the film is Star Trek, the Motion Picture.
Perhaps that's right.
Perhaps the most unoriginal title in film history, but we all called it Star Trek, the Motionless Picture. And if you watch the movie, you'll know why. It's a little slow, isn't it?
Yeah, but I like Star Trek. I mean, I grew up watching Star Trek, so I was really looking forward to it.
Well, so was I, because I love the show too. And, you know, to be honest, if you look at the visual effects, they're absolutely stunning. They're beautiful.
Yeah.
But the story is ponderous and the pacing is slow. I mean, Robert Wise directed it, you know, and he's not known for his science fiction oeuvre. So, but we were very proud of the work, very proud, because we felt it was immaculate. You see, in those days, this was done at Entertainment Effects Group, Doug Trumbull's company, Marina Del Rey, same team that did the whole Blade Runner thing later. And so we were the only studio in the world that would shoot and process all of these composites and visual effects in 65 millimeter negative stock, known as 70 millimeter. When you hear 70 millimeter, it actually includes the soundtrack, but the film negative without sound is 65 millimeters. So what that means is that we're operating with more than about six times the resolution of normal 35 millimeter film. So when we shoot elements of, you know, matte passes or light passes with tiny points of light or graphics and star fields and things like that, the film grain is invisible. And so we had optical printers that we had built in Marina Del Rey that were of such a scale, it was mind-boggling. You'd walk into these rooms and there were granite flats this thick, solid granite, 10 by 15 feet. It's granite so they can't move or warp or change with temperature. And then all of these projectors and prisms and mirrors and filters and cameras and lights and things to combine these layers of film we would shoot separately into a single shot. And we could do it with a precision that was far greater than anyone else in the day because of the size of the film.
Mm-hmm.
So it's now, very special stuff.
You mentioned Blade Runner, but didn't you work on Close Encounters, the special edition, before Blade Runner?
Because Blade Runner was my first model job. You know, I'm not sure exactly the timing, but I believe that I did that later, that the Close Encounters was later.
Okay.
I think so, because when they did the reissue, I think it was after a couple of films that I'd worked on. I'm a little vague on the history, to be honest, but.
Oh, no worries. I had it on the timeline as before Blade Runner, but you're.
When we did that thing for Spielberg, he wanted the same kind of animation that I produced for Star Trek. That stuff we just saw, slot mask animation. And he liked the look of that, and he wanted to see it coming out of the mothership, and he actually wanted to see a pair of eyes form in this sparkly, glittery.
Now, you use the term slot, what is it? The term you?
It's called slot mask animation. The reason they call it that is that, let's say you take a very fine pen and you draw a black line on a piece of white paper. You shoot a film negative of that, graphic film, so big piece of negative stock, little clear line through it. That's the negative. Instead of black, it's now clear. So when you put that on a light table, you have a bright line. You take another one, similar, another bright line or clear line on a black film and lay it on top. And where they cross, basically you have a clear area. Where they cross, you have a point of light. And so if you move them side by side, that point travels. So by the way you draw your lines and the way they are moved with respect to each other, you can control where that light goes, how fast it goes, how bright it is. A lot of things can be controlled by the details of how it's drawn. It's very painstaking work, but easily understood when you get the hang of it. So
Spielberg saw your work in Star Trek and then wanted, but this was not, for people that are listening, this was not the original release of Close Encounters. No. This was after that Spielberg did a special edition in 1980, and he added a sequence with Richard Dreyfuss.
Yeah, that's right. And it was baffling for me because, not being a film guy, not even a fan of film, to be honest, I enjoy film, but it wasn't my life. I was baffled as to why the studio would bother making a duplicate of the movie with some extra stuff on the end. Now, it's pretty cool, but I think generally people appreciate the original more so than the reissue. I'm not sure about that.
Let's take a look at the scene that you actually worked on for the special edition of Close Encounters. So that was your work, the flash and lights.
Yeah, there was a bit more of it in the actual release, print, but that was the beginning of the effect, yes.
Terrific.
Also, I was a model maker on that project too, and I helped build a lot of those interiors you see throughout that whole sequence with all those little aliens. They're little plastic aliens, this big. And those aliens are actually moving. It's hard to tell, but those little guys in the windows, they're moving just a little bit. We made a very peculiar mechanism to make them move just a tiny bit.
So it's kind of... when you were doing all this work, was Spielberg looking over your shoulder, checking what you were doing?
He came around several times, yeah. And I got to work with him later as well on the movie Hook, which was a real pleasure because we worked very closely together in four different ways. But yes, he came through several times. He's very involved and he really does care deeply and has a very clear vision of what he wants, in my experience. And so I found him to be just a pleasure to work with because, when somebody knows what they want, I can give it to them. I just need to know.
Right.
As opposed to some other directors I work with.
Which will remain nameless. Oh. Tell us about Blade Runner. And working with Ridley Scott, 1982, which is now a classic. And before we came on live, we were talking about the fact that when Blade Runner came out, it was not well received by the audience nor the critics. And now, of course, it's a masterpiece.
Kind of classic. It's one of my favorite movies of all time, especially the director's cut. So for me, Blade Runner was a very challenging experience because being my first model making job, I knew that I had to really rise to the challenge. And like I said, I like a challenge and it tends to work for me. And I'm a capable builder. I've always been comfortable in the shop and able to create what I need. But I was working with some people who were master craftsmen, the stuff these guys were building, and a couple of women too, actually, which was really good to see. Was just of a quality that I couldn't even imagine, the machining and the engineering of mechanisms and the way the sculptures were transitioned into molds and castings and then the paintwork. And oh my God, it was really amazing to be among this group of just peak professional artisans and craftsmen. So it was very inspiring. And so I was really happy to be there and I learned a lot. And so I was given small tasks here and there. I think you're going to show a sequence where we're landing on the top of the police station. Is that right?
Yes, yes. Actually, let's take a look at it and then we can talk. Yeah. Continue talking. Leslie, I've seen this movie so many times, including seeing it recently on the big screen. Why is it that this film does not, the special effects do not feel dated, do not look dated?
Well,
unlike other films that, you know, don't, you know, you notice it looks creaky.
Well, there are two reasons, really three reasons. Primarily, it's because of Sid Mead. Sid Mead he passed away a couple of years ago, was a famous futurist, a designer who would draw visions of the future. And if you look up Sid Mead's work, S-Y-D-M-E-A-D, it is beautiful, mind-bending stuff that even now looks way beyond where we're headed. And he was the principal visual concept artist behind Blade Runner. So that's a big part of why, but the other two reasons are, first of all, we were using this compositing hardware at Entertainment Effects Group that I'd mentioned before, the 70 millimeter approach. And so it yielded a clean and high contrast, very precise kind of composite. And so when you look at the original Star Wars, for example, there's some really crappy mats in there. They've remastered it and it looks a lot better now, but boy, I don't know if you remember, you'd see matte lines everywhere and bad contrast ratios. And for me as a technician, I can spot that stuff and it bugs me. There's none of that in Blade Runner. And so the other reason, of course, is Ridley Scott. You know, the man has an incredible eye, and as a visual communicator, he really gets it. So that I think was the third reason.
And like Steven Spielberg, was Ridley Scott working closely with you guys?
No, not at all, in fact. I don't think he ever came through the model shop. He did come down to the facility in Marina Del Rey several times to see dailies and I think approve sequences and that sort of thing. I never got to meet him, but he did come, but he wasn't the same kind of level of involvement. And to be honest, I think it's because he had a lot of other stuff on his plate. The studio was not his friend on the production. He was considered a novice director still. So they were pushing back on a lot of things. He had his hands full. Mm-hmm. And in fact, there's a fun story about that relates to that, about the end of the film.
Yeah, tell me.
Well, in the studio release version, well, first I should say, when Ridley finished his cut and showed it to the studio, they did a test screening with an audience like they used to do all the time. I'm not sure they still do. And you'd fill out a little card, you know, comments. Yeah, they do. You fill out some comments. And a lot of people said two things. I don't get it. And it's got a bummer ending. And it was literally like that simple. And so I'm sure there was some cigar chomping studio head who said, put some Sam Spade narration on this thing and make it a happier ending. Well, when Ridley Scott got this news, he was in London. He'd already finished the film. Everybody was gone. The money was spent. The equipment was returned. It had been disseminated back into the ether of the filmmaking world. And he was at his wit's end about what to do about it. I was told this story by Jake Scott, his son. I was working with Jake on a commercial he was doing. I was supervising visual effects for him at Digital Domain at the time. And we were sitting down at lunch in between the shoot. He heard I'd worked on Blade Runner. He said, I got a great story for you. Ridley had been sitting, eating lunch at Pinewood Studios in London. Now, I've eaten at that commissary and all they serve is dog food. It's really awful food. It's the worst British food you can imagine. It looks like dog food. So he was having lunch with Stanley Kubrick, his friend Stanley Kubrick, who had just finished a film and really was saying, God, Stanley, I don't know what I'm going to do. I've got no people, no cameras, and no budget left. I don't know how to change the ending. We can't just cut it to be happier. And so Stanley Kubrick pushed across the table a stack of film cans. And he said, maybe this will help. And it was excess leftover aerial footage from The Shining, where they're flying over snow-capped mountains, coming up to the lodge. There's a long sequence of that in the film. And so Ridley thought, okay, maybe Decker and the girl are fleeing the city because they're both replicants. They know they're going to get hunted. They're just going to have whatever time they have left together. And they're in the spinner. They're flying over these mountains. Yeah, that's it. So he came back to LA, to Marina Del Rey, and went to our place in the marina. And we put up a mock-up of the spinner that we already had on a motion base. It had a big, you know, acrylic dome, the windshield, and we put a big projection screen behind him and rear projected this aerial footage and at the right angle. And we shot a couple shots of them in the spinner, looking at each other, flying, and you see the mountains go by. So that happily ever after snow-covered journey ending comes from The Shining.
Wow. I never heard this.
Very few people know, but I've heard it now from two different sources that know, including Jake. He told me.
But you were involved in putting that together. But you.
Well, I didn't work on that because it was full size live action. I was in the miniature crew, but I was there. I watched him shoot it. It was fascinating to me because I was a novice, and I realized now after hearing that story from Jake, and I told Jake, oh man, I was there when they shot that. Is that where that came from? I had no idea at the time. Nobody knew, because of course no one would say that. I'm sure the lawyers would have a field day with it. But that's where it comes from.
That's a great story. Yeah. So I want to stick to film, but you actually had a very successful career making commercials as well. Yeah. And yeah. This was parallel to your work in film, correct?
Well, it was really sequential. You see, when I was working at a place called Digital Domain in Marina Del Rey, I started there just before True Lies. And then after True Lies, we did a few more things. And then we did Apollo, and I got nominated. And they wanted to keep me there. They liked what I was doing. One of the three founders, you see, Digital Domain was founded by Jim Cameron, Scott Ross, who used to run ILM, and he's here in Santa Barbara now, and Stan Winston, famous makeup effects and creature effects guy.
Yep.
Wonderful guy, passed away a few years ago. He's terrific. So this place was a revolutionary visual effects facility, and I was lucky enough to be working in the model shop. Well, after Apollo, we did Titanic. So that by then I was supervising the model department, the whole wing of the company at the time. And so in 1 year, I supervised the miniature work and budgeted and, you know, estimated and a huge amount of work on three films: Dante's Peak, the largest miniatures film project ever undertaken, The Fifth Element for Luc Besson, and Titanic for Jim Cameron. Well, after Titanic, during this year that almost killed me because it was so hard, I spent over $8 million in 1 year. I realized miniatures are over. This is done, because we were doing CG Titanics for long shots that looked every bit as good as a model. And they were better because you could fly around them, you could make a wake, you could change the lighting, you know, animation brings a whole level of control that's not available to a miniature. And I realized I need to find something else, some other way to make a living. So that year I had my annual performance review and I told them, look, I got to start visual effects supervising. That's the next step up from where I was in the company and in the hierarchy. And that was a reach. It was a big ask because I was not a digital artist. Now, I had been watching carefully what was going on in the company and sitting with artists and watching them work and learning what the programs could do and what they couldn't do and how the work pipelines were set up. And I picked it up pretty quick. I wasn't operating any of the programs, but I understood them well enough to be able to manage projects. And so they thought about it, and Scott Ross, who was the CEO, said, give this guy a shot. So they did. And so I got to choose between film and commercials. And I knew I had a very steep learning curve to get through. So I chose commercials because the turnaround time is much, much quicker. 12 weeks or so for a commercial at the most. And in film, it's a whole year. So basically, I would learn a lot quicker in commercials. I knew I needed to. So another thing that influenced my choice was that at the time, digital domain was number one in the world for commercial visual effects. But we were not number one for film. We were number two or three, arguably. So I thought, well, why not start at the top? So I chose commercials, and I supervised commercials at DD for 10 years before I left. I was there for 14 years in the end.
Now, in 1994, you got to work with James Cameron and with True Lies.
Yeah, I worked with him three times.
Yeah, True Lies, Titanic, and what was that?
Well, the other one was a thing he did for Universal Theme Park Studios. It was Terminator 2 Battle Through Time.
Yeah. The
3D stereoscopic ride experience thing in a theater with, you know, robots. And
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah. It was
cool. So tell us about working in True Lies. Did you work on the Causeway bridge?
Yeah. That was the main thing. My friend Mark Stetson, that I mentioned earlier, had a company called Stetson Visual Services for many years, and I worked with him a lot. He would always bring me in as a crew chief, kind of the leader, you know, head thinker, organizer guy. And so Mark was trying to get the job to build this Causeway explosion sequence miniature. It's a scene in the movie where these bad guys are in a big moving, kind of a cube van, and they've got a nuclear bomb, and they're driving down the causeway, that long causeway over the water in the Florida Keys, and two Harrier jets go in and shoot rockets at the bridge and blow it up, and the truck crashes, and everybody's happy, except for the terrorists. Another friend of mine, Pat McClung, this was before I worked at Digital Domain. Pat McClung was the head of the model division at Digital Domain in those days. He was the first guy. His early days. This was our first big movie at DD. He knew what I was capable of and, you know, who I was. He worked with me for years. And he told Mark, if you hire Les to run this job as a crew chief, you got the contract. And so Mark was like, well, you're probably going to hire him anyway. So I said, sure, because he was going to hire me anyway. So I and Richard Stutzman, a physical effects guy, another dear friend, were the co-crew chiefs at this subcontractor, Mark Stetson's shop, to do the Causeway sequence. And so I went in and started to look at the project, and it turned into an incredibly complex project. For that project, I had to write an environmental impact report for the federal government. I had to design 7 boats. I had to develop ways to anchor a miniature to a delicate protected coral reef, dead coral, but coral reef all the same, and how to shoot in water just deep enough to be a pain in the ass, and build a very fragile miniature designed to break apart in Marina del Rey, truck it to Florida, unload it, load it onto a boat, drive the boat out to the site, put the miniature together on the water. And we're talking about slabs of plaster this thick, 5 feet wide and 10 feet long, that are just brittle as a Ritz cracker. They're terribly fragile, purposely. And make it all work. And then I had to, it's just so complicated. The physics of that explosion are very complicated because it had to look big, but it wasn't. And it had to, all the materials had to behave properly in terms of physics at high speed camera capture rates. And we had to do it twice. Wow. So it was a mind-bendingly complicated job.
Let's take a look at the sequence, and then you can continue telling us about it.
Okay.
Marines, it's time to kick ass. Recommend using your Mavericks to take out the bridge.
Roger that. Line plate switch Mavericks. 2.
These missiles won't set off those nukes, will they?
Negative. That's a negative, Flank 01.
Thank you.
shooting, Marines.
And, it looks so real.
Well, that was because I did a lot of research and controlled every detail of how things were built. The truck, for example, the box on the truck, normally you would just put that thing together out of plastic or maybe aluminum or wood, but I had the guys pop rivet it together out of very thin ribs of aluminum and use very thin aluminum to delicately glue it on so it would bend and rack and come apart the way a real box truck would if you dropped it from 40 feet in the air. That sort of thing where one of the most complicated aspects of that particular model was that after the explosion, the aftermath had to match full size aftermath that they built as a set about 30 miles up the Keys at their other full size chute location. They built fake broken, already after the explosion, chunks of bridge with rebar hanging out and stumps of towers remaining and all that. So I had to make a model that we blew the shit out of and have everything left be exactly like what they shot in Florida.
Now, was James hanging over you, looking over your shoulder, demanding all this stuff?
No, not particularly, but I knew him and knew what he was like. And I've never had a problem at all working with Jim Carrey. He has a bad reputation for being mean and yelling a lot and stuff. I've never had a problem. And I believe mostly that's because my stuff works.
Yeah, I know Jim well, and he knows exactly what he wants.
And I really appreciate that.
Yeah, and he's developed an unnecessary reputation.
I agree. I think he's terrific. And, the only direct interaction I had with Jim on this project was that truck earlier in the film smashes into a couple of cars or something. It's got some dents in the front and a cracked windshield. Well, we built a perfectly good cube van, not collided, but we made the bodywork out of sheet lead, very thin sheet lead. And so my first assignment was to take that truck and drive up to where Jim was shooting live action stuff. He was shooting the Harrier's landing. It was amazing. And have Jim dent the truck the way he wanted it. Because I knew that if we had him do it, he couldn't complain about how it was done. So we had still photographs and they had the van there and it was great fun. We had a good time actually. He took a little ball peen hammer and he's there, okay, gotta be right here. So whack, and he bangs on the front of the van and puts a good dent in it. Yeah, that's good. Okay, and then scrape a little paint off here, and then took a little like an ice pick and scratch the windshield to make the cracks. And because he's a very multi-talented guy, he's an expert model maker, he's an amazing artist, an incredible designer, of course, and all of the rest. So he was well capable of doing this, and it was really fun to have him bang up his own model and go back and shoot it.
That's great. And so this was 1994, and then 1995, Apollo 13.
Yeah.
Your Academy Award nominated work. Tell us about the challenge of putting all of this together.
It was my dream job. I've always been a space nut. Even when I was a kid, I remember watching the Apollo 13 mission on TV. I just love all that stuff. I have such admiration for the technology and the people behind it. And so for me, I was just like, are you kidding? I get to make a movie out of this? Mm-hmm. And so my friend Pat, I mentioned before, yes, was still running the model shop. And you see, after True Lies, Jim Cameron liked that sequence we just saw so much that he wanted to do one more shot, which was looking up at the cloud of debris from the explosion and see the van come through the cloud, crash down on the bridge in front of camera. And then as it crosses camera like a skateboarder on a rail, and then it falls off in front of camera and blows up. He wanted that shot. So I was hired this time directly by DD to come back to Marina Del Rey with all the crap we could rescue from Florida, all the broken pieces and the smashed up van. We just put it all in a truck and brought it back. And Richard Stutzman, the physical effects guy, and I built this rig in the parking lot in Venice. This was in Venice now. And we tried for about 3.5 weeks to get it just right. We'd launch the truck, we'd create a cloud, launch the truck at the bridge, and it kept tumbling, it wouldn't slide. And finally I figured out what was wrong. The front tire of the truck was catching and making it tumble. So I just made a fake tire out of plywood that would slide, and that fixed it. So we got the shot. The day we finally got the shot, after 3.5 weeks of struggling, he cut the shot from the movie.
Oh my goodness.
He does that sort of thing. So when Apollo 13 came along, I was incredibly excited. And so I set about immediately doing research. I like doing research on historical projects. I think, you know, truth has to be well represented, and then it just feels right. And so I wrote a letter to the curator of the Houston NASA Historical Archives and told him, I'm a model maker in Hollywood. We're making this movie about Apollo 13. And would you mind sending me a little bit of reference material? You know, what have you got? And I got back this enormous crate, chock full of the most amazing stuff, things that had never left Houston before, photocopies mostly, but binders that tell you how to prepare the spacecraft for launch. You know, every detail, every system, it was amazing. And I read every bit of it. I just loved it. I was like, this is a fantasy for me. And so it turned out that I learned a lot about the mission, pretty much everything I could learn. And then my knowledge of physics also contributed to the veracity of what we were producing.
Wow.
This is part of why I was chosen to be on the nomination list, is that I became the mission authority consultant, if you will, at DD. So all the animation artists and the camera people and the pyro guys, they could come to me and ask, well, what does this retro rocket look like when it fires in space? You know, what does it actually produce? And I could tell them, what does urine do when you pump it out of a spacecraft into the vacuum of space? I wrote a textbook page on what that is for the artists so they could animate. So for me, there was a multifaceted level to this job that was really fun and really challenging. And then I also got to supervise a really talented crew of model makers and direct them and coordinate them, building all of the components for the various shots. And it got very complicated.
But Leslie, when we were talking about Star Trek and Blade Runner, you talked that you love, I mean, that it was great creating things that were new, that, that were imagined. Mm-hmm. And now in True Lies and Apollo 13, you've shifted your work to accuracy and to historical aspects. Which one, is there one that you prefer more?
Well, actually, they're both involved in projects like Titanic and Apollo that are historical pieces. There is really just as much innovation. It's just not visible to the eye on a piece of film.
In what way?
Well, a good example is that on Apollo 13, we had a stack of spacecraft in space that we had to shoot from a million different angles. And replace parts and, you know, mount them differently, like from the end, like a shish kebab, or on the side, like the letter T, or from four different directions. And so this means that the miniature inside needs a very rigid skeleton that can be recombined, reattached to itself and to the mount that is moving it, because these are computer controlled motors that turn the spacecraft slowly or make it, you know, rotate. And so the precision of that mounting has to be absolute, because the center of gravity is changing, and if the spacecraft kind of takes a dip, you know, because it's loose, you can't use that shot. So I had to engineer a new way to attach this metal pole coming out of this computer controlled machine, how to attach that to the inside skeleton of the rocket. It's called an armature. And so my armature mount was something no one had ever done before. It was just I just engineered it on some paper and showed the machinists, and we made a couple and tested it, worked great. And it's something you could release with a single wrench and a tap of a hammer, it just pops right off. So that's one level of innovation as an example that's invisible, but has a great result of quality in the end product. Materials evolution is also a factor, where we began using epoxy resins the moment they were available. Silicones and other types of paints, ultraviolet reactive paint was used in some cases. So there is a lot of technical innovation that's not visible on the film, but is definitely contributing to the end product quality.
Let's take another look at Apollo 13.
We've got a problem here.
So how did it feel, Leslie, to get nominated for the Oscar?
Oh man, I was really surprised, to be honest, because I was just a model maker. Really, I was just a member of the crew. I was a lead member, but still, model makers just don't get nominated normally. But I was at a company called Digital Domain. And this company, we were a bunch of pirates. We just didn't do stuff the way other people do. So my friend Pat McClung, for example, who was the guy who hired me, he was running the model department. He had been nominated the previous year, I think, for True Lies. And he was just a model maker. So it wasn't unprecedented, but it was very unusual. And I was really humbled and I felt very appreciated. And the reason I was nominated in large part was because Pat McClung, being the head of the department, was initially on that list of four people. But Pat said, oh no, Les should be on this list, not me. I've been nominated, put him on that list. He's why it worked, you know, whatever. And so that's one big reason why I got nominated, was thanks to Pat. Thank you, Pat. And so that was really rewarding. And it was also kind of vindicating, because model makers have been a very underappreciated level of production hierarchy for a long, long time. The top 200 grossing films of all time are all visual effects movies. Mm-hmm. And most of those movies are before computers. And so those were model makers or physical effects people. And so that is something that's just not recognized by the film industry very much. So I was really proud of our clan of artisans and master craftsmen. And I've made a point to acknowledge them very clearly. There's a really funny thing that happened too, because we were nominated against Babe, the movie Babe, the talking pig. Mm-hmm. Great movie, mm-hmm. I love that movie. Yeah. And they did beautiful work. I was really impressed with their work. They did stuff the hard way and it was good. And a lot of my friends worked on it down in Australia. Well, a few weeks after the nominations were announced, I got a FedEx at work at Digital Domain. It was a Nike shoebox with a FedEx label slapped on it, taped all up. No return address. I couldn't see who sent it to me. I don't know how you do that, but that was what it was. Like, I don't know where this came from, but okay. I open it up and inside is an Oscar carved out of ham.
Oh my God.
My friends in Australia saw me on the nomination list and said, oh, well, let's send Les a little present. So they froze a ham and carved an Oscar and FedExed it next day from Australia to Marina Del Rey, to Venice actually, and to my name, and there's my Oscar. And so everyone in the company had their picture taken with their Oscar made of ham. It was a really funny gesture.
That's adorable. That's very funny. So I have to ask you about working with Ron Howard. Was he hovering over you like James Cameron?
Well, no, actually, he did come by several times, and so did Tom Hanks, and that was great. He was really sweet. He was very interested in what we were doing. It was fascinating to him. And so Ron Howard did come by several times, and he was always really approachable, just like you would imagine. He's just the nicest, easygoing guy, you know. No pretense at all of superiority or authority, but clearly knows what he wants. And his mastery at storytelling is unchallenged. And so for me, again, working for someone who knows what they want, it's just my favorite thing. Because the opposite is really difficult.
I will be remiss if I don't ask you about the Island of Dr. Moreau, which you did right after Apollo 13.
Well, I barely touched that movie. I'm not even sure what I did on that movie, to be honest, but that was a really odd project. There again, you know, we read the scripts when we get these jobs, and nobody could quite get why they were making this movie, because it was just so weird. I don't know if anyone out there has seen it. It's just
I saw it and then I saw there's an incredible documentary about the making of.
It was an achievement for sure, just very odd. But I don't think I really did much on that at all. If anything, I was probably supervising the team that did some work on it. I'm not even sure.
Oh, so you don't have any juicy gossip to tell us?
No, I'm sorry.
even recently, there's a documentary, you must have heard about it, called Val, about Val Kilmer, and he has behind the scenes home movies that he did about the shooting of the island of Dr. Moreau.
Strange movie.
Yeah, the one of the biggest bombs in movie history.
Yeah,
and it's in your credit.
Well, I know it's strange. I don't know why I should take it out. but you know, it's a fact that in my whole career, there have, out of all those movies, and that list you have is only partial. I can list in these two fingers the number of movies we knew were going to be good: Blade Runner and Titanic. I mean, Apollo 13, we thought, yeah, probably going to be good, but you know, there are ways to mess that up. But we knew Titanic was going to be great because the story was so solid, and it's Jim Cameron. And then Blade Runner was just so revolutionary, and it looked so good. We just knew, and the story was really great. We knew this was going to be an unprecedented film. So it's rare.
Yeah, but if you remember, leading up to the release of Titanic, the media was carving the knives against Titanic.
Totally. We know how it ends. Everyone knows how it ends. That's what they
said. Yeah, and that it was costing $200 million and that it was going to be a disaster, et cetera, et cetera.
One of the highest movies of all time.
And speaking of Titanic, let's take a look at your work in Titanic. Still get goosebumps watching that sequence.
Me too, for different reasons.
So all of that was model making.
Yes, primarily. When you see scenes of like the deck is tilting and people are sliding down and bouncing off of things, so the closer stuff where you don't see like a lot of the ship, that was done as stunt work in Rosarito, Mexico. When you see a wider shot, those are digital people bouncing off of a miniature ship, a model. Mm-hmm. So, and then when of course it's rearing up and it breaks and you see people falling and it's very wide, those are digital people also, digital stunt people, we called them. And that's all model. So we broke a lot of models in that movie. Yeah, it was extremely complicated. I had a really amazing team running the whole operation. I sort of stood back from that and hired two crew chiefs to run the model operation. And I just had to manage the interaction between them and the physical effects people and the camera, live action, editorial, make sure everything was covered. And in fact, our hero model of the Titanic, hero meaning the best quality one we built for close-up work, was 44 feet long and 6 feet wide, about 12 feet tall. And this was a massive model. We shot it in the Howard Hughes Spruce Goose Hangar down in Playa del Rey. It's where Playa Vista is now. It's where they built the tail section of the Spruce Goose. So we shot it all down there. And I had my team detail every square inch of that boat so that we could get close up on any of it and just shoot. We wouldn't have to go in and super detail an area for a shot coming up, because that was impossible to manage. See, Jim Cameron was being extremely strict with digital domain, and if we had missed a day in our shoot schedule, it would have probably tanked to the company, the way it was set up. It was brutal. It was the most difficult project I've ever worked on. And so I went way over budget on that model, but they never had to wait a moment to shoot any of it. It was all ready to go at any time. And in fact, it's the most detailed and accurate model ever built of the Titanic, including the one they built at the shipyard before they built the ship. And so that model was so extraordinary that the Smithsonian called us, and with our publicist, we made a deal with the Smithsonian where they were going to design a permanent exhibit about the Titanic incident around our miniature.
Wow.
But then Rupert Murdoch heard about it. And he said, oh no, I'm taking that model to Australia to buy a theme park. Well, I've got a Titanic theme park happening. I want that model in Australia. And we were like, are you kidding? It's just going to rot in Australia. 20 people are going to go to your theme park and then it's just going to rot. The Smithsonian would like to have it. Don't you think that's a good idea? Oh no, I'm taking the boat. It was really depressing. I got so angry that I went to the stage where we were storing it and I tore off this chunk of the Titanic off the deck and screamed, you know, screw you, Rupert Murdoch, and sent it to Australia. We had spares, it's okay. But I was really angry, and all the crew was, nobody could believe it was such a waste. And that model in fact did sit there and rot in Australia for years. But Jim Cameron went back just a few years ago with a team and without permission, walked onto that theme park and had their guys disassemble it. It was made to come apart so it could go into two shipping containers. And he stole the model back. And now it's in Long Beach in a hangar, perfectly restored in excellent condition. Yay, Jim.
Yes. Now, I meant to ask you earlier, when you're working in all this project like Apollo 13 and Titanic and True Lies, you've read the script and the director has filled you in on exactly what they're looking for.
Yeah, we always would get the script and they would be careful about us, you know, signing non-disclosures and register the script and all that. Movies are always secret until they come out.
And does your role, do you have any input into, like, you know, once you read the script, you know, maybe we should do this in a particular, in a different way, or it's just do the work?
Well, as a visual effects supervisor, you should have input. Not all projects are structured that way or open to that. But as a visual effects supervisor, you can spot problems before anyone else knows about them. And so I have changed quite a number of scripts. I was shooting with John Woo in China and redesigned an entire battle sequence for him because what he had in the script was simply not producible. And he was glad I did, and we shot it and it worked. So it does happen, but it's rare. As a model maker, there's absolutely no input because that's all that's been decided already. It's further down the path of evolution. And so it's not an option usually.
Well, you know, I could go on talking to you, Leslie. This has been so much fun. But before you go, you know, I want to mention that you worked on Edward Scissorhands, and then also adaptation with Spike Jonze.
That was fun.
Yeah, and it was the animation sequence in adaptation, correct?
Yeah, right in the beginning of the film, the lead character goes outside the stage where they're shooting his movie and leans against the stage and says, oh God, how did I get here? And we cut to the earth as a ball of lava and watch it evolve into present day in about 60 seconds. So through the, you know, dinosaur, or the birth of life and the oceans and the dinosaurs and the ice age and present day, really quick. And it was really fun to design that sequence and to have that produced by animators, very talented people at Digital Domain.
And do you see, how do you see the special effects evolving, and do you have any opinion about what's happening, you know, currently, not right now, but I mean, what has been happening in the past few years with special effects?
Yeah, well, you know, I'm really delighted, actually. I think it's getting to the point where when we go to the Academy of Motion Pictures in Beverly Hills to watch the 10 presentations of films that could be nominated for visual effects. It's called the Visual Effects Bake Off. It's open to the public, by the way. It's an amazing experience to go and see. It's getting really difficult to say one is better than the other, because mm-hmm. although you may not like the film, the quality of the work is almost universally stellar. So it's getting really hard to critique work that is perfect. So yeah. I tend to go more towards art and creativity and innovation. That's what really turns me on. So I tend to vote in that direction. But it's getting very difficult. And I think that's a really good thing, because what's happening is visual effects are getting more democratized. It's easier for filmmakers of lesser projects, smaller projects, to have access to quality visual effects. There are more people doing them. The hardware is cheaper. The software is cheaper and much more capable. It's faster. So it means that we're going to see visual effects filtering down into very small projects. In fact, a lot of documentaries are now using visual effects. Last season. So I think it's a really positive trend, because it's just another tool in the box. When I don't like visual effects, it's because they're being sort of fawned over by the production and like, look at this amazing stuff we can do. Isn't this just the coolest thing? And there's just too much of that, I think. And when it's used to augment the story, it's always got to be about the story. This has always been an emphasis of mine, and it's what I emphasize when I work with young filmmakers in the Cinema Society and in the film festival. First and last is story. We all worship the same God, and it's the story. And so when visual effects distract us, take us out of the story experience, that's a failure. That's the only thing I'm seeing nowadays that bothers me.
Correct, exactly. Well, Leslie, what a pleasure to chat with you.
Thank you, Roger, this is made for me.
Yeah, we've talked for over an hour and we could go on talking. But
I could tell more stories for sure.
Excellent, but thanks for taking the time, and I will see you very soon.
Thank you, I hope so. Be well.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye, everybody.